Let's take a look at an example. We're given a function. We want to find and classify these critical points, okay? First thing we might notice is that the domain, well, it's a rational function, so it's defined everywhere the denominator is non-zero. So it's defined from minus infinity to 1 and from 1 to infinity. So how do we find those critical numbers? Well, we need the derivative. We've got a rational function, so let's use the quotient rule. The derivative of the top is 2x times the bottom minus the top times the derivative of the bottom divided by denominator squared. Let's clean this up. We have 2x squared minus 2x minus x squared, careful, distribute that minus sign, minus 3 over x minus 1 squared. So we have x squared minus 2x minus 3 over x minus 1 squared. So numerator factors, x minus 3, x plus 1, over x minus 1 squared, okay? All right, so we've factored our derivative, right? We computed the derivative, we've simplified it, and for our purposes right now, simplified means completely factored. And so the next step is to write down our sine diagram for this function. Okay? Now, we have to mark off the two zeros. We can see that the derivative is going to be 0 when x equals 3 and when x is equal to minus 1. The other point we should mark off is we should mark off that vertical asymptote at 1. Okay? Now, different people have different conventions for how they write this down. I like to do it with solid dots for zeros, hollow dots for my asymptotes, places where the derivative is undefined. And one thing to keep in mind here is that this point 1, right, it's a vertical asymptote, right? This is a vertical asymptote at 1. Here's where, so f prime of 3 is 0. Right, f prime of minus 1 is 0. Those are sort of our points of interest. So there's an asymptote at 1, right? So 1 is not a critical number because you don't get a point on the graph. There's no critical point there, right? You don't get a point on the graph at an asymptote. So it's not a critical number, but you still have to mark it on this sign chart because the derivative could potentially change signs at that asymptote. It turns out this one won't. We'll see that in a second. But something you have to watch out for, right? You need it there because you need to get the correct signs in each interval. So that's the next step. We say, all right, what signs? We've got 1, 2, 3, 4 intervals here. What goes in? Pick a number bigger than 3. Think about 4, for example. We're going to see that all of these factors are positive, right? So everything is positive here. We've got an increasing function, okay? Between 1 and 3. 2, for example, but you don't have to actually plug in 2, what's going to happen? Well, this is going to be negative, right? If x is less than 3, this will be negative. But x is still bigger than 1, so x minus 1 is positive. This will still be positive, right? Because we're taking a positive number, we're adding 1. Okay, so negative, positive, positive, and in fact it's squared, right? So even if this were negative, we're squaring it. So 1 negative, 2 positives, overall negative, decreasing, okay? What about at minus 1? Well, that's our asymptote, so we want to see what happens when we cross. We go to, say, 0, for example, right? Well, when we cross from bigger than 1 to smaller than 1, well, x minus 1 will change sign, but we're squaring, right? So this denominator remains positive because of that even power. It's always positive. And nothing happens to the numerator when we cross x equals 1. So we're still negative here. We're still decreasing. Okay? All right. And again, if you're not confident with that, plug in 0 minus 3 times 1 over 1 is minus 3 is negative, right? Finally, if x is less than minus 1, you can try minus 2. You realize that this factor is going to become negative. So now negative times negative over something that's always positive. Two negatives gives you a positive. And so we're increasing, right? Okay. So what does this tell me? This tells me that, well, first of all, f is increasing on minus infinity to minus 1 and the interval from 3 to infinity. F is decreasing on minus 1 to 1 and 1 to 3. Notice here, we don't say that it's decreasing from minus 1 to 3. We have to leave 1 out, right? Because 1's not part of the domain, so we leave it out. Okay. And finally, we can classify the critical numbers. There are two critical numbers at minus 1 and 3. Remember, this is not a critical number because it's an asymptote. And so we see that minus 1, f of minus 1, we change from increasing to decreasing. So that's a maximum. So that's a local max, relative max, if you like. And at 3, f of 3, we go from decreasing to increasing. So that is a minimum. Okay. And the question didn't ask for them. So maybe we'll be lazy, we won't compute those y values. If you really wanted to, we can take that minus 1, plug it back in up here, right? We get, what, negative 3 over 2 at that local max. Take the 3, plug it in, get that, right? So you can work out the y values for the local max and the local min. It might concern you that actually at the maximum we have a smaller y value than we have at the minimum, but there's this asymptote in between them, and that's going to throw things off, right? We know that we have this vertical asymptote at 1. And if you look at the original function, the numerator is always positive. So this thing is positive to the right, negative to the left. So we know that the graph is looking like that over there. It's looking like that over there. And so, yeah, this makes sense now, right? It's going to come down to some local minimum up here and then head back up. There's going to be a local maximum, right? And then it heads back down, right? So it makes sense in this case that the local max is actually below the local min just because there's this intervening asymptote that throws things off like that.